core. It's like there's a hardcore group of surfers. Like everyone's really stoked, and you'll see them out there in the middle of winter when it's 35 degrees and the water's 35 and snowing and giant. All your friends, everyone's stoked.
Did you see Danny's wave over there?
Did he get a sick one?
He just got the most retarded tube down the
left
beach.
Or right?
Left.
Holy shit. I swear, I wiped out on one, right? And I'm on the inside and I look back and this wave breaking on my head, Ross pulled off. When the wave broke in front of me, the explosion was like at least 15 foot. And I was like this. I was like this, dude. Look at my face.
It's way different than out in California where you can have the option to surf every single day. You know, it might be flat here for 3 weeks to a month, and then, you know, everyone's jonesing to surf, and then there's like one day we get the waves, but when we get it, it's like massive, you know, double overhead. Some of the best waves in the world right out in front here.
We're a close-knit community. Everybody seems to be really, really friendly with each other, and there's no animosity, that's for sure.
Localism. Just like anywhere, you got your hardcore locals, you got your people who are a little nicer, your people who are not so much, but just like anywhere, if you go and be cool, if you're in a new spot, give respect, don't try to paddle right to the peak. Back in the day, it was different. We would just let our surfer do the talking.
Jersey's interesting, you know, we get some long flat spells and it's really hard to keep up with. So you have to be really dedicated and you have to kind of know what's going on, especially with the weather. Surf forecasting plays a big role. So you got to be on the, you know, you got to basically know what's going on weather-wise and try to time it. But surfing New Jersey is it's kind of its own deal because, like I said, it's super inconsistent and we, you know, we get some really, really classic days, but you have to be ready for it and you kind of have to clear your schedule. So it's not as easy just to be like, oh yeah, I'm going to go surf today when you have take care of the kids or you have to work or do something else. So you have to really time it out and plan it and say, you know, it looks good next Wednesday and you gotta try to figure out what's gonna make it work.
And this swell came out of nowhere because like there really wasn't much weather. Like yesterday was kind of calm and like, I guess we had some wind last night, but.
My name is George Gales. I'm the owner of Surf Unlimited. We're one of the only year-round shops on Long Beach Island. We've been open since 1974. Started off as a one-floor surf shop with two floors, surfboards and wetsuits on one, clothing, all the big brand clothing lines on the main floor. We do bike rentals, surfboard lessons, board rentals. We're one of the only shops on the East Coast that locally shapes surfboards at the shop.
Oh, up, 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 up.
We also take an active role in our community. We sponsor a lot of local events, the Jetty Clam Jam, the LBI Fest on Long Beach Island, which is for local businesses. We also sponsor, we have a moto surf event that we sponsored.
George a few years ago. I'll just say that George was like, like anybody, you know, who doesn't really know motocross or, he knew surfing, of course, but he's like, he asked me, he's like, now why would I want to sponsor an event like this? So with my enthusiasm and explaining how much you can relate the two sports and how much discipline But the art of it, both sports, I'm like pretending I'm doing a turn. Got the idea from Moto Surf. Well, it's funny, my brother actually came up with the idea, Bill. I was three of us, me and Bill and Scott up late in Puerto Rico, and Scott ran contests forever. So nobody was doing nobody was doing anything like it over here, but they've been doing the surfacross for years in California. So it was spawned in Puerto Rico, the idea. And then that year we put it all together and had a bunch of people, a bunch of our friends who were riding, were all practicing surfing, and then I didn't ride, so then I was teaching these guys how to surf, and then they were teaching me how to ride, and then we had surfers practicing riding and vice versa. It was just awesome.
Hey, how are you?
Hey, look how pretty
you are. Oh man, at one point I got so scared. I need to have duct tape wrapping my bottom things. So all of a sudden I heard click, 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 and I thought I got stuck in the chain. I'm going, ah!
And we set up the teams with surfers and motocross guys so that local surfers or local motocross guys have another sport to do.
Because it's a team event, and it's take the combined scores, and just because some guy surfs real good don't mean he rides motocross real good. Or just Barry Carson is our most famous motocrosser. He's a good friend of ours, and Barry's just got a great track record of him. So he had a great career. He had a pro license and was in the top 100 riders in the nation. With the AMA, he got an award for being in the top 100 riders for over 26 years, which is unheard of. Like Kaylee Imamala is another good friend of mine who I met through the Malleola Foundation. Went out to Hawaii one year. I had sent a message through Facebook to Sonny Garcia, and Sonny, super nice guy. I don't care what anybody says or what his reputation may be. He's one of the nicest people, warmest people you ever meet. Didn't even know me from a hole in a wall, and lent me a bike, lent me gear, took me riding, and I ended up meeting Kalal Alexander. Kalal Alexander is the vice president of the Malleola. So when I was talking to him, he was telling me all about how they help the kids with cystic fibrosis learn how to surf as a natural treatment. And it's been proven to greatly reduce their meds, and also give them just a better outlook on everything. Kaylee, he's funny because I was asking the guys all there on the cystic fibrosis day, I was like, anyone want to ride after this? And he was just all into it. Hell yeah, I'll ride, So we became friends from that point on, and that was a handful of years ago, but I've been like psychotic, like... Like, I love it. I want to keep doing it and get, make it bigger.
Thank you.
Oh yeah, it's a fucking arm pump. Crazy. I crashed. I couldn't see, man. I got in this run. I went, wow, man. I'm gonna go grab my girl, get some water. All right, need on there. Yeah. Shot. Me, you, and your friend almost all in that corner right there, huh?
That was good, right?
That was so much fun. You belong on the A class, man.
Huh? Oh, it was a good time. I actually sort of remember how to ride after about the third lap. I started remembering how to go through turns. But it was a good time. Good time. Dusty. Very dusty. I was trying to get a good jump, and you were like this, and we were literally.
You gotta watch, cause there ain't room for three bikes in that corner. You know?
We were rubbing, we were like right there, dude. And I like let off, and I was like trying to like stay straight. So I think you looked back at me too.
Everybody have fun.
Wait, that was a great.
That was fun, right?
I had a good time. Actually,
who was hitting that big jump? Just that one kid.
What's gonna happen out there?
I gotta beat this guy right here. He came in third, I came in fourth. He's the man to smoke.
That's your, you're gonna be chasing him?
Presser. Put him in third. I hope.
How'd it go?
It went well, man.
It went bad. It went bad for me. It's good, but it's bad.
It was a great race. Man. Great race, dude.
Blow me.
Man, that's all competition right there, man. That's all competition.
We got this next race coming up. It's all the surfers, the surfer class. Some of these guys absolutely kill it. I'm so stoked to be in this race with these guys. It's gonna be so much fun, man. We're gonna battle it out right to the end, man. Right to the end.
I don't know, I did my best, passed you people, I'll take it. Time for a Heineken.
Tomorrow we go home, go surf.
Oh, tomorrow's gonna be just as awesome as today.
Today's anybody's game, very, very close.
How's the condition?
Conditions, it could be worse. It's choppy, it's small, but it's contestable. I've seen worse. I've seen contests and smaller, flatter stuff. So, we should be thankful.
Yeah, I'm the bad judge. I can be easily influenced, though. Doesn't take too much. Alcohol works, sex, drugs, money too, sometimes.
You gonna take any bribes?
Oh, absolutely. I heard about these moto guys, you know, that's how they roll, so I'll go with whatever they want to do.
Two good scores, your top two waves, that's what you're going to be judged on. So you're going out, you can catch a maximum of 10 waves, but you're looking for your top two waves.
All that I thought it would feel, yeah. The night is
side on the left. Looking.
5, 4, there's the last wave. 3, 2, 1.
Got it.
We got all kinds of awards and stuff. Whoa.
Won a trash can, man.
First place.
Somebody won. Somebody won a trash can. Gift certificates from LexMax. They get a free, everybody in the top three get a free yoga class. Get gift certificates for tattoos. And actually, my friend Mitch is giving third place the highest. Second, last, first, last. Because he said a guy in third is going to need a tattoo the most. What else we got? Got gift certificates to Trapani's Racing. We got trophies and loot. We got loot and we got plaques for everybody.
And that means today's winners are Barry and Joey.
Yeah. Oh, dude. You fucking gave it a hell of a go, dude. Good job, man. Here you go. Here's a check. All right. And you guys got some trophies over here.
Oh, yeah.
Your options?
I was going to change some for the
wood. You're not allowed to.
Nice.
What's that?
Thanks to everybody. It was a lot of fun.
Can you guys cash the checks on Wednesday?
Jetty was founded in 2003. This was our 10th anniversary year. We, four friends and I, had graduated high school, or college rather, and we're sitting around. My buddies had just got back from a snowboard trip in Vermont, and I was broke, didn't go on the trip, but they came back and said that the whole trip they discussed the idea of starting a surf brand, and they kind of cut me in on it, and next thing you know, we had a business meeting sitting around my kitchen table, and Jetty was born. Clam Jam is something I'm super passionate about. A few of us in and outside of Jetty met 7-8 years ago, and decided that there was a real lack of togetherness as far as the surf community on LBI goes, and we thought putting together a cool contest would bring the generations together. And just the format of it, where we pair a younger surfer with a more experienced one, it's totally random. We have a promotional night at the Black Whale every September. We pick the teams, everybody's name is on a clamshell, and from there we wait for good waves. We try not to sacrifice any integrity of the contest. We always want to have it in decent waves. And it just always ends up being like a favorite day for the people that are in and around our community. People bring their dogs, their kids. Usually the weather's decent for the fall, for October time of year. And you get to just hang out with all the people that make our community what it is. You know, whether they own a business or are one of your customers that patronize your business, or a guy that you always see out there surfing. There's several combinations of families where the father and the son, or the father and the two sons compete. So what's better than that? It's just a way to bring everybody together. And since it happens after the Chowder Fest, it's a good way for our community to celebrate kind of the postseason.
Hurricane Sandy was rough. You know, normally hurricanes pop up and we're like, everybody's so excited, you know, can't wait to get some hurricane swell. That one threw us for a loop.
The days after Hurricane Sandy definitely were the most mesmerizing moments, because I remember 2 days after the storm, I paddled out up 25th Street to Surf City, and it was just me, Randy, and Royce out, and it was as good as it gets there. And not a soul in sight. You look towards the beach and there were helicopters flying around. It looked like something out of a movie, like the end of the world.
Well, it actually feels exactly the same way they did several days now, making a left-hand turn toward the coastline by the time we get into Monday. Wind field from this storm is incredibly impressive. We've got tropical storm force winds 1,000 miles across in this storm, and hurricane force winds about 200 miles across. It basically means it doesn't matter where this storm comes on shore for anything other than the storm surge, which is expected to be about 4 to 10 feet high.
grinding my teeth, trying to fight the feeling, the thought of you with him. It was ripping and peeling this heart apart till I just stumbled down the path to recovering is humble now. Oh Lord, oh Lord.
The latest, including that mandatory evacuation that they're announcing now for Barrier Islands, Cape May County for Sunday. More on that on NJ1015.com.
How do you feel about the Marvelous being like one of the only boats out there right now?
Getting a little nervous. This guy's got one up the street, but he's got, it's definitely not as heavy as a boat. Should have took it out of order.
Indiana Cap San Boulevard, 11:30 at night, Sunday night, on the eve of the day before the storm hits. As you can see, we got some nice wave action here. I'd say about the surge about 1 to 2 feet up right now, and it's not looking good for tomorrow. I can tell you that right now. Not looking too good. If we got this much wave activity today, I can only imagine what it's gonna be like tomorrow night.
Lincoln Tunnel. You've got light traffic right now on the George Washington Bridge. Lower level construction back to the Jersey side. So many closures around the area.
It was ripping and peeling this heart apart till I just stumbled down. The path to recovering is humble now. Oh Lord, oh Lord. Step to the edge, 'cause my anger drives me. Look down at the ground that will soon survive me. My blood is hot, but this heart's grown cold. Find me a woman with a heart of gold. This fever is burning the tears away. Why did it have to? Why did it have to be this way?
President Barack Obama comes to New Jersey this afternoon to assess storm damage at the shore. The governor plans to ask for an assigned Army Corps of Engineers to start working on rebuilding the state's beaches. Power restoration efforts continue across the state. Crews are trying to bring folks back online. They could be in the dark for days.
It was hit or miss on the island. A lot of the island got a lot of water damage, but some of the island got completely destroyed.
I got a pair of crusty underwear and two pairs of socks. Just been waiting on this email. We're currently on the bus and gonna be getting it done. Check out the damages.
So fortunate.
we're home here. It's kind of fucking. Only if you could get that smell. Get that smell. Oh, honey, we're home.
Sweet. Well, that's that.
Huh. Just skate up here on my skateboard, you know? Board in hand, just fucking. Well, let's jump in the ocean, you know? Let's get in there and, it's not gonna happen for a while.
Some things that I've done, you know, general basic tear outs right after the storm, helping people clean up, close friends and family of mine, business owners, so forth and such.
Step to the edge, 'cause my anger drives me. Look down at the ground that will soon survive me. My blood is hot, but this heart's grown cold. Find me a woman with a heart of gold. This fever is burning the tears away. Why did it have to? Why did it have to be this way? So
honestly, not a week goes by that I don't think about that time frame, and it's a year later now. And right here at my desk in this office was where I spent a majority of my time. I had to handle just the huge volume of orders that came in for the Sandy Relief t-shirts, and it basically exposed our small company for what it was, and the inefficiencies of not automatically charging credit cards and PayPal accounts, not having the hands out there to fold all those shirts and print them all and send them out every day. Dealing with the post office, you know, when we're used to this time of year right now, we're sending out 30, 40 packages a day on a good day maybe. And then we were, you know, swamped with hundreds and hundreds of orders a day. The Sandy Relief tee, it was two days after the storm when we released it, and we got them online, and we had like 2,500 orders for them within the first like 48 hours, and everything just went right into motion, and we just had to start printing them. And the guys and a lot of volunteers came and manually printed, at this point, you know, probably well over 30,000 garments.
We have these people that are here on the island that are invested and live here and love it and want to make it better and stronger, have banded together. And you know, you get companies like Jetty that have come out and have donated, you know, over $350,000 back into this community to make it better and stronger. And that's what it's all about. You know, if you look up and down the coast, how many companies have taken this this chance to sacrifice some of their own well-being and some of their product to make their community stronger. And I think that's a testament to what we have here in Long Beach Island.
I think it's going to take some time for the rebuilding, so especially places like up north, Manilocking, Holgate, and even you drive around this island and through North Beach, all the ocean fronts and Love Ladies are still doing a mass amount of work.
They're definitely going to bounce back. Like I said, it's just going to take some time. You know, I will say that there's been a lot of good people who've been working hard to make it happen, though.
Let the rain fall on you. Let the pain seep on through. Don't you let another day. Well, I just wanna get lost and hide and feed off the ground with the one that sun wouldn't rise till I saw your eyes. Moments lost in pure nirvana. I know it's wrong, but I know I want to. Recovering all so poorly. Gonna let the band speak for me. The only way to get this out is through this tune. Well, I just wanna get lost, head high, and feet off the ground. There's a wall before me, but I am gonna break through. 'Cause I'm just a drifter, dreamer, believer. You don't know lust until you've seen her. The bright eyes control me, light me up when they'll roll right over me.
I don't know, start off with the typical stereotypes of the Italian Americans that we get up from Staten Island. That seems to plague our culture here. Everybody thinks we're a bunch of fist bumpers, which is not the case at all whatsoever, but Jersey surf scene here is awesome. Love it to death. Definitely a lot different than anywhere else in the world, I'd like to say. We're a close-knit community. Everybody seems to be really, really friendly with each other, and there's no animosity. That's where I had the itis ever since I started bodyboarding. I was like 7 or 8 years old. Just never looked back as much as I possibly could. Begging my parents, you know, to help me get a wetsuit for the wintertime. As rudimentary as they were at the time, you know, they were pretty still pretty technologically advanced as far as warmth goes. I guess the most memorable moments were probably when I was a lot younger, seeing like how world class the waves were here, from you know, hurricanes like Hurricane Gloria, Hurricane Bob. When I was that young, it was so small. You know, when you're younger, you're a lot more intimidated by the bigger waves and stuff like that. And actually seeing it all come to fruition, like waves that I had seen in like the surfer mags or in videos when I was a younger kid. So. I've been with Harvey Cedars Beach Patrol for 16 years. I've been a captain for 4 years here. Prior to that, I was a lieutenant. Prior to that, I was a regular lifeguard. Just my natural attraction to the water led me to being a lifeguard. And, you know, God bless my old captain, Zeke Hill, who still works for the Beach Patrol here, who, you know, showed me the ropes, so to speak, and showed me the how to do everything and be a part of the community here is one of my favorite things. All over the world, all over Central America, the continental United States, Southeast Asia, Indonesia, you know, the Caribbean, Fiji, Australia, all over the world. Very, very fortunate, very, very thankful. I count my blessings every day, that's for sure.
So yeah, when I was growing up, I surfed. I had the option of surfing either Long John or Seaside, which I did both a lot. And summertime we take boats across because we live on the water, so we take boats across to Island Beach, which is pretty cool. Say that I love the South End, Long Beach Island when it's on, any one of the major spots. just Barrel Central, and then for being around the world to these other spots, I will say it's world. It can be world class. It's not often, but it can be world class. And also, I will say that if you could surf our biggest days, like people who, young kids wanting, you know, growing up wanting to go to Hawaii, wanting to test themselves and better themselves or be a pro or whatever it is, or if you can surf the biggest days Jersey has and on the latest, steepest drops and get barreled, you have a leg up. You know, people from here who are really good at surfing and then they go there, have a little bit better of a chance to get some good ones. I have been to Barbados a few times. I've been to Puerto Rico countless number of times. We actually have property there. It's like a second home. Spent probably about 5 or 6 winters in Hawaii. Been to California, Southern California a few times. Surfed up and down the East Coast.
Perfect. I started surfing when I was about 13 years old. I grew up on the beaches of LBI with my brothers. We were all, you know, spongers and skimboarding and all that stuff. And then sure enough, my cousin picked up a surfboard. And I wanted to jump on and see what it was like. And that was about 13 years old, and I haven't stopped since. There was a huge crew in Long Beach Island, believe it or not. When I was growing up, I was watching guys like Ben McBrien and George Mershon, Greg Luker. These guys were just out every swell and even all winter, and just watching them basically shred and trying to keep up with them. Even guys like Randy Townsend, I was watching him surf. You know, even though same age as me, he was just that much further ahead at that stage in the game, and it was just impressive to watch and try to learn from those guys. Doomsday last year was probably one of the heaviest days I've ever experienced in Long Beach Island. It was December 21st, 2013, and it was scary. We had a lot of big days, but that was definitely by far one of the biggest because how thick the swell, the waves were, and how heavy it was. So that was definitely, I mean, I didn't get a ton of good waves. I saw a lot of good waves, but it was impressive to be out there with the power that was out there. And it was, you know, I was surfing with guys like Randy, Frank Walsh. Well, when I was growing up, it was actually a little bit more localized where you had certain breaks like Hudson, and the jetty at Hudson was like, you know, if you didn't know what you were doing, then forget it, beat it, you know. And it was a lot of talk. But nowadays, there's certain sections of the island where you see certain guys out every swell. And I think there's a lot more respect these days. I think surfing has gotten so big that there's so many more people doing it, but also there's a whole crew of guys that are doing it all winter long. And I think there's a lot of respect that goes on for that crew. I started traveling basically when I was in college. My first trip was to Barbados. It was back like in 99, a bunch of friends. And then from then on, every year I tried to take a trip. You know, I was in college doing trips during the winter. And then, once I finished college, I would continue traveling. I did a semester abroad in Australia from when I was at Stockton College, and that was cool. I did Indonesia and New Zealand, and every year I'd try to do a different trip or try to go back to somewhere I really like Costa Rica, Barbados, Puerto Rico, British Virgin Islands, Bahamas. You know, there's a slew of places that I've been to, and I, you know, just keep going back to some similar ones over time.
When I was around 5, I remember surfing on a boogie board in a short break. My dad was pushing me in and stuff. I don't think I really got into it like hardcore till I was in like 7th grade, I'd say. We were paddling out on a hurricane swell on the south end with my dad. It was like double overhead probably, so I only caught like one wave, but that was an eye opener. I was really into skimboarding probably from like 11 years old to like 15. I skimmed a lot, and I took that pretty quick. A lot of competition with that and stuff, and then kind of like got bored with that and started surfing a lot more. So I've done a lot of my surfing from age like 15, 16 till now. I grew up watching my dad and my brother surf all the time, so it was like second nature just to pick up a surfboard and go for it.
And who were some of the people you idolized around here growing up?
When I was younger, before I really started surfing, I used to watch guys like Greg Luker, Justin Sitta, Mike Roth, Randy, Ben McBrien, my brother Brendan, Kretzer. The list goes on. It's like a never-ending list. But my dad, Randy, let me borrow his 610 one one winter, and I rode it a few times, and this one swell came, and he was in Costa Rica, and it was dead low tide, and me and Danny Mears paddled out, and my third wave, I was paddling for it, and the thing jacked up and threw me out into the flats, and the board came over in the lip and broke right over my head. I almost blacked out underwater. I got washed up to the beach and almost like puked, and the board broke in half. That was like the heaviest moment I've ever had out here. Middle of winter. Surfed California a few years, up and down the whole East Coast, Puerto Rico, and recently I went to Pipe down to Hawaii, caught a few waves there. That was a fun trip.
Later on, through landfall and through some of the events we ran, we immediately stocked up area shelters and food banks. That was our mini famous run to Costco and Walmart, and you know, spending 10 grand and having a line of like 25 shopping carts. And we had called the shelters before that and asked them what they needed. We didn't want to just get them, you know, 1,000 bottles of water and 1,000 blankets. They told us, you know, we need toilet paper, we need toothpaste, we need, you know, certain things. So we went and bought those. And then from that point on, it was basically empowering other nonprofits and bringing aid to the emergency responders. We delivered air mattresses to several of the area firehouses, because there were guys from all over the state and out of state sleeping on concrete floors. We brought fruit to the National Guard because we heard that they were eating really bad. That was just a small thing, but I thought that was cool. We donated to a Thanksgiving food drive because Thanksgiving snuck up quickly, and people, you know, let alone didn't have a house to eat in, but maybe didn't have funds to have a Thanksgiving dinner. So we supported a community-wide Thanksgiving dinner by donating to the Southern Regional Education Fund. We ran an East Coast Rising event at the Long Beach Island Foundation of the Arts and Sciences. That was our first event after Sandy, and it was in January. Had a great turnout. We raised like 15 grand just showing a little movie that some guys from New York had made about the relief efforts.
Somewhere when I- new now. Big rock on the boot, knock on the boot, knock, bust the way that I throw.
Yeah. So funky, like a street junkie. Like I said before, here we go. Come on, come on. For Pete's sake, I break an update. Wait, I radiate a dub play to navigate the tunes I make. I fit like a slipper, so catch the big dipper. Vital signs are quicker, not the flatline picture. The Showtime original, official is a smooth criminal. I hit the cliches or the subliminal. With the sole technician to fill the prescription. In addition, listen close to the mission. The P-E-T-E-R-O-C-K resume with the root to root by Faberge. No doubt for shout about a 20-bar segment. Offspring of lyrics when the microphone's pregnant. Give it a rough down, now here's the sermon. Everywhere you go, you hear Mecca from the Vernon. Pound for pound, uptown, I get down and bound to spin the record like a merry-go-round. The klepto flow that I touch is not a preemie. And who would ever see me when I dream a genie? I don't think so. Peace, I gotta go and shake like an earthquake. Cousin, for Pete's sake.
For Pete's sake. Comes the rugged one, bust the way I flip it. I collect the loot, then I knock the boot. Yeah. A smooth dark rubber, prefer to be all a chocolate lover, cause I could do wonders undercover.
What?
I'm dip dope, I bind like Lizzo. I cleanse like soap, cause it's the great black hope. Stay away from the B now, I can rock the C now. Yeah. Huns always wave, cause I'm slick like Lou now. Peep rock on the boot knock, bust the way that I flow. Yo, my style cock diesel, and I can do the hustle. Niggas know the time, I don't have to flex a muscle.
Yeah.
Not the type to fake it, I wouldn't try to take it. Tie your girl to the back of my Jeep, butt naked. Slide a monkey ass down the hill. So if you don't want beef, money chill, for Pete's sake.